So, I have been trying to make this video for probably about 3 years now. And the sense of needing to do it has gotten really bad over the past few months because I feel like before I post any more videos of singing or showing the things I love to do, I think it's important to know why I haven't been doing them. And I don't know. For me, I guess this is an easier way of explaining than to tell everyone in my life what's been happening. And yeah, so when thinking about this video and how I wanted to go about this, I wasn't really sure how to start it. So, I guess I finally decided to just say what happened. And so, at the end of January of this year, I suffered a nervous breakdown. And what's funny about it, which isn't actually really funny, but I'd actually had a psychiatric analysis before the breakdown ever happened. I'll get to that later. So, if you don't know what a nervous breakdown, or you're more used to the colloquialism it's used as, a nervous breakdown is like the deterioration of a person's mental health until they can no longer function in their daily lives. So, I knew this was coming for a long time, but I tried to stifle it, and I had a couple people in my life who enabled that a lot and basically told me to hide it, don't deal with it, suck it up, get over it, get over it. It's just in your head, which it's not. And so with the nervous breakdown, I ended up missing almost a month of school. I lost the job I had, which I was gonna quit anyways because it was probably contributing to why I had a nervous breakdown, so that wasn't really a big loss to me. I ended a relationship, which ended up being the best thing I ever could have done, BT dubs, but I couldn't leave my house. I was suicidal. I had my parents home with me at all times. Someone had to be there to make sure I didn't do anything and that I was safe. If I left the house, I could only leave for like half an hour, and I had to have a parent with me. My dad actually ended up taking a week off work just to make sure there was someone home with me. So with the mental health, with the psychiatric assessment. So I had known my mental health was bad for a while. I knew a couple of the things that were happening, and then I was diagnosed with things I didn't know what were happening. One of the main diagnoses was bipolar 2 disorder, which briefly is a disorder consisting of two episodes, manic or hypomanic and depressive. Depressive episodes are like what people with depression experience, but generally a shorter span. Generally, they start at 2 weeks and onwards. And then a manic or a hypomanic episode, and being bipolar 2, I have hypomanic episodes. It's a intense mood of elevation. You tend to get really, really like confident in yourself. And you do really reckless things because you don't think of the consequences. Your mind is racing at 1 mile per minute. You can't like stop talking. Like you spend much more than you should and get yourself into debt, as I have done a couple times now. So I'd known about that, and I was trying to get treatment, and things would seem like they were working for a while, and then they just would stop. So that didn't help. I got my diagnosis of post-traumatic stress, which I knew about and I've talked about in another video. from the drunk driving accident I was in. So I knew about that. That was no shock to me whatsoever. Like, whatever. I got the possible diagnosis, which was later confirmed, of generalized anxiety disorder. I got the possible diagnosis, which was later confirmed, of, what's it called? Borderline personality disorder, which is, it's a hard one to explain. It's a personality disorder is not an easy thing to detect because it has very, it's a personality disorder. It shows up as personality traits. But a lot of people with it show like very intense outbursts of anger. They have attachment issues, so if they start feeling like they're attached to someone or start caring about someone, they start to push them away and isolate themselves. And then the one that really shocked me was body dysmorphic disorder. And I didn't really realize anything was wrong with me regarding that, because I just thought, oh, well, everyone puts this much effort in. Like, I didn't realize how much of my time was spent in fixing myself and hiding myself and just trying to be someone I'm not. And when I was diagnosed, with good insight, which means that I know it's there. I know the thoughts aren't right and aren't accurate, but I still think them. And body dysmorphic is a type of obsessive compulsive disorder. It has a lot of obsessive and intrusive thoughts. For me, I spend, and this is how she kind of, the psychiatrist figured out what I had, was she asked me how much time I spent on my appearance, either hiding perceived flaws, whichever, and I said 70% of the time. Yeah, so, and I thought that was normal. I didn't really realize it was an issue until I said it out loud, and it was kind of this moment of, oh, yeah. And one of the other reasons I was diagnosed with that is because of a symptom called picking, which I don't talk about. I think maybe like 5 people in my life know about me doing it outside of my family. And it's like what it says it is. It's like picking. And it's a way of compensating for what you feel because suddenly you control it. It's a flaw you're trying to fix that isn't there. And then afterwards you just feel like this immense guilt and anger, and it sucks because you have marked your body with these things because you have thought there was a flaw there that wasn't there, and it's your way of trying to like fix that flaw, but in the end you just bring on a bigger one. And it's something I'm still working on. It's a lot harder to stop than you would think because it does become habitual, and it becomes an obsession. You feel like you have to do it, but then you get to a point where you don't even realize you're doing it. You're just completely detached from your body and doing this. And yeah, so it's kind of been a rough year. But so when the breakdown happened, I had to really sit and think to myself, like, okay, where do you go from here? Like, you're rock bottom, where do you go? So I went to a doctor, my doctor, and we went over the assessment, and she said, okay, like, we need to start you on these mood stabilizers, get everything kind of normal so we can tell what other things are happening, so we could confirm the generalized anxiety and we could confirm the borderline personality. And so it's tri-rating, I think the word is, where you just slowly up the dose. So we had to up it every 2 weeks to the treatment level just to make sure, because one of the side effects is Stevens-Johnson syndrome, which is like a deadly rash, so you can die from a rash apparently. So we had to make sure that didn't happen. And so I've been on the mood stabilizer since February, and I feel like way, way better. Like, even if I'm in one of my episodes of depression or hypomania, it's not nearly as bad as it was. I like to compare it to like being in this hole. So without medication, I'm in this hole. I can't even see the top. Like, there's no way. There's nothing out of it. But with the medication, I can see the light at the top, and I can like almost reach, and I'm like, if maybe if I jump, maybe if I just try a little harder, I can get there. And that's kind of, it's a lot better feeling to have, like, if you've experienced it. Like, because then you know how, like, much of a step that is. And so, I did go back to school. I was actually told by one of my professors that I should just drop out, because I wasn't going to get caught up. And so, proved her wrong. And I went back. I got completely caught up. And I passed all my classes with very good grades, better than most of my classmates who had been there that entire time. I got a new job, and it's a job I love. The owners know what's happening with me. They know what's happened. They 100% support me and are doing whatever they can to make me feel happy and included and make sure I'm in a good environment, which is amazing because I've never really had a job like that before. And I'm at a point where I need to start building back relationships with people who I kind of stopped talking to or just lost contact with because I was dealing with what was going on and I was isolating myself and trying to deal with it. Because when you have a mental health issue, you get into this place of isolation. You're like, no one gets it. No one here understands what's going on. They can never understand, like, they don't want to be near me. They don't want to be near someone who's such a freak, who's such a trouble, who's such a burden on them. And so you push them away and say, like, I'm not going to do that to someone. It's whatever. But, so you lose a lot of people in your life. And I've lost touch with a lot of people that I wish I could bring back into my life. And, so I do want to start reaching back out to people, and I'm hopefully gonna do that soon. It's a work in progress. But I have found through this whole thing is that these steps to take to get back to a healthy place are very small and very slow. But you get there eventually. Like, for example, like one of the things was just to get out of bed before 2 in the afternoon. It's very long and it's very hard. And to anyone else who is dealing with any kind of mental health and feels like this is it, or that they need to end their life, or they have nothing better for them, I look at it as if you're at a crossroads, and one road is easy. You don't do anything, you just go, and you accept life as what it is, you just go with it. The other road is brutal. There's all these paths and obstacles, and it is going to take every fiber of your being to get through that, but at the end of it is your happiness, and I think that's worth fighting for, and it's going to be an everyday fight. You are never going to... You may have a day where you wake up and you're just feeling great, you feel wonderful, and like those days are like amazing. But a lot of days you are going to have to fight just to get out of bed, to get to work, to get to school, to get things done. Like, but it's worth it. It's really worth it. It's not worth ending your life. It's not worth giving up on your life, because there is so much more waiting for you. I've got my little angel helping me out here. I've also learned through this how many people I have in my life that I didn't really expect anything from, and who were
had my back the entire time and still have my back and are supporting me and making sure that they're doing whatever they can to make me happy and help me get to where I want to be. And that's amazing. Just friends inviting me out to do things or coming over or randomly giving me chocolate when they seem upset. And yes, I'm talking about you, Daisy. It is so important to know that even if you feel completely alone, like no one understands, and maybe no one does understand because you're the only one going through this, is your life. No one is going to go through the exact same thing that you're going through. But there are people there who support you and want to see you happy and want to do whatever they can to help you get there. And yes, no one can really help you. It is something you have to do by yourself. You have to go seek help. You have to do it. But these people are standing beside you and cheering you on and helping you go. And that's so important. And even to the point of people just, you make plans with them and you say like, look, I can't go out today. Like, I'm just, it's a really bad day. Like, I can't do anything. And they just say, okay, well, replan. They don't get angry. They just, they know that this is something you need. And my friends right now are like amazing. And they have been so supportive all along. One of my best friends sends me messages every so often just saying, hey, you know, I'm thinking about you. Hope your day's going well. Like, praying for you. And I mean, I could not ask for a better support network, and I'm super grateful to everyone who has helped me get to where I am today. And I'm not perfect, I'm not 100% okay yet, and I may not ever be, but that's okay because I'm striving to be there, and maybe it will happen, maybe it won't, maybe it'll happen and I'll go bad again, but that is life. Life is just a roller coaster of good and bad times, as cheesy as that sounds, but it's very important to know that if someone is pushing you away or starting to isolate themselves, it's probably not you, it's them. And the best thing you can do for someone if you think they're dealing with mental health or you know they're dealing with mental health is to reach out and let them know that you are here and show them, because everyone says, oh, you know, I'm here if you want to talk, but a lot of people don't show it and they're not necessarily there. Show it. Send them those text messages saying, hey, you know, I'm thinking about you, like, I hope everything's going okay today, like that. Or invite them to go somewhere, because even if they say no, it's nice to be invited. It helps a lot to know that people want to be around you. Or little gestures, like my friend who gives the chocolate whenever I looked like I was sad or feeling crappy. And the journey's a lot easier when you've got your own cheerleading team. Yeah, so to everyone that I've lost contact with, it hasn't been you. It has been mostly me. I mean, it's never fully one-sided, but I do tend to push people away because I honestly just don't know how to talk to people after I've lost them for 10 years, because it's like, oh, hey, we haven't talked in a while, how are you? Oh, well, I suffered a nervous breakdown, but otherwise, I'm okay, how are you? How's life going? So it's, yeah, so I just wanted to make this video and explain to everyone what's been going on and let you know that I am working very hard to get in a better place. I am in a much better place than I was in January or since like October of last year. I am working on music. I am working on a lot of things I used to love and still do love, but kind of lost the motivation for. So I'm getting back into it. So let's do this.